As this traveler through the cosmos proceeded on his meditative journey with increased eagerness and a bouquet of nazis and faith itself like a spring gathered from the garden of the spring that opened before his truth perceiving intellect, his cognitive reason, the gate to the animal and bird realm. With hundreds of thousands of different voices and various tones, he was invited to enter. Entering, he saw that all the animals and birds in their different species, groups, and nations were proclaiming silently and aloud, "There is no God but He," and had thus turned the face of the earth into a vast place of invocation, an expansive assembly for the proclamation of God's glory. He saw each of them to be like an oath dedicated to God, a word proclaiming His glory, a letter indicating His mercy, each of them describing the Maker and offering Him thanks and encomium. It was as if the senses, powers, members, and instruments of those animals and birds were orderly and balanced words or perfect and disciplined expressions. He observed three great and comprehensive truths indicating in decisive form their offering of thanks to the Creator and Provider and their testimony to His unity. The first, their being brought into existence with wisdom and purpose, and their creation full of art in a fashion that in no way can be attributed to chance, to blind force, or inanimate nature, their being created and composed in purposive and knowledgeable manner, their animation and being given life in a way that displays in 20 aspects the manifestation of knowledge, wisdom, and will, all of this is a truth that bears witness to the necessary existence of the eternal living and self-substance, His seven attributes, and unity, a witness repeated to the number of all animate beings. The second, there appears from the distinction made among those infinite beings and from their adornment and decoration in a fashion by which their features are different, their shapes adorned, their proportions measured and symmetrical, and their forms well ordered, there appears from this a truth so vast and powerful that none other than the one powerful over all things, the one knowledgeable of all things, could lay claim to it. This comprehensive act, which displays in every respect thousands of wonders and instances of wisdom, it is impossible and precluded that anything other than such a one could lay claim to it. The third, the emergence and unfolding of those countless creatures in their hundreds of thousands of different shapes and forms, each of which is a miracle of wisdom, their emergence from eggs and drops of water called sperm that are identical with each other or closely resemble each other and are limited and finite in number, all this in the most orderly, symmetrical, and unfailing fashion, is so brilliant a truth as to be illuminated with proofs and evidences as numerous as the animals themselves. By the consensus of these three truths, all the species of animals are engaged together in testifying that there is no God but He. It is as if the whole earth, like a great man, were saying there is no God but He in a manner befitting its vastness and conveying its testimony to the dwellers of the heaven. The traveler saw this and understood it perfectly. In expression of these truths, we sat in the seventh degree of the first station. There is no God but God, to whose necessary existence in unity points the consensus of all animals and birds that praise God and bear witness to Him with the words of their senses, their faculties and powers, words well balanced, ordered and eloquent, with the words of their limbs and members, words perfect and persuasive by the testimony of the sublimity of the comprehensiveness of the truth of bringing into being, making, and creating, according to will, the truth of distinction and decoration according to purpose, and the truth of proportioning and forming according to wisdom. Definite too is the indication given by the truth of the opening of all of their orderly, distinct, variegated, and infinite forms out of identical or similar eggs and drops of sperm that are finite and limited. That meditative voyager, in order to advance farther in the infinite degrees and countless luminous stages of knowledge of God, then wished to enter the world of man, the realm of humanity. Humanity, headed by the prophets, invited him and he accepted the invitation. Looking first at the stopping place of the past, he saw that all of the prophets, peace and blessings be upon him, the most luminous and perfect of humankind, were residing in Qur'an, no God but he, and making remembrance of God. With the power of their brilliant, well attested and innumerable miracles, they were proclaiming God's unity, and in order to advance man from the animal state of angelic degree, they were instructing men and summoning them to believe in God. Kneeling down in that school of light, he too paid heed to the lesson. He saw that in the hands of each of those teachers, the most exalted and renowned all of celebrated human beings, there were numerous miracles bestowed on them by the Creator of all being as a sign confirming their mission. Further, a large group of men, a whole community, had confirmed their claims and come to believe at their hands, a truth assented to and confirmed by these hundreds of thousands of serious and veracious individuals, unanimously and in full agreement, was bound to be firm and definitive. He understood, too, that the people of misguidance, in denying a truth attested and affirmed by so many veracious witnesses, were committing a most grievous error, indeed crime, and were therefore deserving of a most grievous punishment. He recognized, by contrast, those who assented to the truth and believed in it as being the most true and righteous, and a further degree of the sanctity of belief became apparent to him. Yes, the infinite miracles bestowed by God on the prophets, peace be upon them, each one being like a confirmation of their mission, the heavenly blows dealt to their opponents, each being like a proof of their truthfulness, their individual perfections, each one being like an indication of their righteousness, their veracious teachings, the strength of their faith, a witness to their honesty, their supreme seriousness, and readiness to self-sacrifice, the sacred books and pages held by their hands, their countless peoples who through following their paths attain truth, perfection, and light, thus proving again the truthfulness of the teachings, the unanimous agreements of the prophets, those most earnest warners, and their followers in all positive matters, their concord, mutual support, and affinity, all of this constitutes so powerful a proof that no power on earth can confront it, and no doubt or hesitation can survive it. Our traveler understood further that inclusion of belief in all the prophets, peace be upon them, among the pillars of belief, represents another great source of strength. Thus, he derived great benefit of faith from their lessons, in expression of which we said in the 8th degree of the first station. There is no God but God, to the necessity of whose existence in unity points the unanimity of all the prophets through the power of their luminous miracles that both affirm and are affirmed. That questing traveler, having derived a lofty test of truth from the power of belief, found himself invited, while coming from the assembly of the prophets, peace be upon them, to the classroom of those profound, original, exacting scholars who affirm the claims of the prophets, peace be upon them, with the most decisive and powerful proofs, and who are known as the profound and most veracious ones. Entering their classroom, he saw thousands of geniuses and hundreds of thousands of exact and exalted scholars probing all the affirmative matters connected with faith, headed by the necessity of God's existence and His unity, with such profound demonstrations as to leave not the least room for doubt. Indeed, the fact that they are agreed in the principles and pillars of belief, despite their differences in capacity and outlook, and that each of them relies on a firm and certitudinous proof, is in itself such evidence that it can be doubted only if it is possible for a similar number of intelligent and perspicuous man to arrive at a single result. Otherwise, the only way for the denier to oppose them is to display his ignorance, his utter ignorance, and his obstinacy with respect to negative matters that admit neither of denial nor affirmation. He will in effect be closing his eyes, but the one who closes his eyes is able to turn day into night only for himself. The traveler learned that the lights emitted in this vast and magnificent classroom by these respected and profound scholars had been illumining half of the globe for more than 1,000 years. He found in it moral and spiritual force that the combined strength of all the people of denial would be unable to shake or destroy. In brief allusion to the lesson learned by the traveler in this classroom, we said in the 9th degree of the first station. There is no God but God, to whose necessary existence in unity points the agreement of all of the profound scholars with the power of their resplendent, certain, and unanimous proofs. Our contemplative traveler came forth from the classroom ardently desiring to see the lights that are to be observed in the continuous strengthening and development of faith and in advancing from the degree of the knowledge of certainty to that of the vision of certainty. He then found himself summoned by thousands or millions of spiritual gods who were striving toward the truth and attaining the vision of certainty in the shade of the highway of Muhammad, upon whom be blessings and peace, and the ascension of Muhammad, upon whom be blessings and peace. This they were doing in a meeting place, a hospice, a place of remembrance and preceptorship that was abundantly luminous and vast as a plain, being formed from the merging of countless small hospices and convents. Upon entering, he found that those spiritual guides, people of unveiling and wondrous deeds, were unanimously proclaiming no God but He on the basis of their witnessing and unveiling of the unseen and the wondrous deeds they had been enabled to perform. They were proclaiming the necessary existence and unity of God. The traveler observed how manifest and clear must be a truth to which unanimously subscribe these sacred geniuses and luminous Gnostics. For, like the sun is known through the 7 colors in its light, the saints' luminous colors, their light-filled hues, their true paths, and right ways, and various courses are manifested from the light of the pre-eternal sun through 70 colors, indeed, through colors to the number of the divine names, and are all different. He saw that the unanimity of the prophets and the agreement of the profound scholars and accord of the saints forms a supreme consensus more brilliant than the daylight that demonstrates the existence of the sun. In brief allusion to the benefit derived by our traveler from the Sufi hospice, we said in the 10th degree of the first station. There is no God but God, to whose necessary existence in unity points the unanimity of the saints in their manifest, well-affirmed, and attested definitions of the truth and wondrous deeds. Now, our traveler through the world, aware that the most important and greatest of all human perfections, indeed the very source and origin of all such perfections, is the love of God that arises from belief in God and the knowledge of God, wished with all of his powers, outer and inner, to advance still farther in the strengthening of his faith and the development of his knowledge. He therefore raised his head and gazing at the heavens said to himself, "The most precious thing in the universe is life. All things are made subordinate to life. The most precious of all living beings is the animate, and the most precious of the animate is the conscious. Each century and each year, the globe is engaged in emptying and refilling itself in order to augment this most precious substance. It follows then, without doubt, that the magnificent and ornate heavens must have appropriate people in inhabitants possessing life, spirit, and consciousness for events relating to seeing and speaking with the angels, such as the appearance of Gabriel, peace be upon him, in the presence of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, and in the view of the companions, have been transmitted and related from the most ancient times. Would then that I could converse with the inhabitants of the heavens and learn their thoughts on this matter. For their words concerning the creature of the cosmos are the most important. As he was thus thinking to himself, he suddenly heard a heavenly voice. If you wish to meet us and hearken to our lesson, then know that before all others we have believed in the articles of faith brought by means of us to the prophets, headed by the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, who brought the Qur'an of miraculous exposition. Then too, all of the pure spirits from among us that have appeared before men have, unanimously and without exception, borne witness to the necessary existence, the unity, and the sacred attributes of the Creator of this cosmos, and proclaimed this with one accord. The affinity and mutual correspondence of these countless proclamations is a guide for you as bright as the sun. Thus, the traveler's light of faith shone and rose from the earth to the heavens. In brief allusion to the lesson learned by the traveler from the angels, we sat in the 11th degree of the first station. There is no God but God, to whose necessary existence in unity points the unanimity of the angels that appear to human gaze, and who speak to the elect among men with their mutually corresponding and confirming messages. Then, that ardent and inquisitive traveler, having learned from the tongues of various realms of creation in the manifest realm, in their material and corporeal aspects, and from the utterance of their modes of being, desired to study and journey through the world of the unseen and the intermediate realm, and thus to investigate the reality. There opened to him the gate of upright and luminous intellects, of sound and illuminate hearts, that are like the seed of man who is the fruit of the universe, and despite their slight girth, can expand virtually to embrace the whole of the cosmos. He looked and saw a series of human isthmuses linking the realm of the unseen with that of the manifest, and the context between those two realms, and the interchanges between them insofar as they affect man, taking place at those points. Addressing his intellect and his heart, he said, "Come, the path leading to truth from these counterparts of yours is shorter. We should benefit by studying their qualities, natures, and colors concerning faith that we find here, not by listening to the lessons given by the tongues of disposition, as was previously the case." Beginning his study, he saw that the belief and firm conviction concerning the divine unity that all luminous intellects possessed, despite their varying capacities and differing, even opposing, methods and outlooks, was the same, and that their steadfast and confident certainty and assurance was one. They had, therefore, to be relying on a single, unchanging truth. Their roots were sunk in a profound truth and could not be plucked out. Their unanimity concerning faith, the necessary existence and unity of God, was an unbreakable and luminous chain, a brightly lit window opening onto the world of the truth. He saw also that the unanimous, assured, and sublime unveilings and witnessings of the pillars of belief enjoyed by all the sound and luminous intellects, whose methods were various and outlooks divergent, corresponded to and agreed with each other on the matter of the divine unity. All those luminous hearts turned and joined to the truth and manifesting it, each a small throne of dominical knowledge, a comprehensive mirror of God's eternal beatitudeness, were like so many windows opened onto the sun of the truth. Taken together, they were like a supreme mirror, like an ocean reflecting the sun. Their agreement and unanimity concerning the necessary existence and unity of God was an unfailing and reliable most perfect guide, most elevated preceptor. For it is in no way possible or conceivable that a supposition other than the truth, an untrue thought, a false attribute, should so consistently and decisively be able to deceive simultaneously so many sharp eyes, or to induce illusion in them. Not even the foolish sophists who deny the cosmos would agree with the corrupt and dissipated intellect that held such a thing possible. All of this our traveler understood, and he said, together with his own intellect and heart, I have believed in God. In brief allusion to the benefit derived from upright intellects and luminous hearts by our traveler for knowledge of belief, we sat in the 12th and 13th degrees of the first station. There is no God but God, to whose necessary existence in unity points the consensus of all upright intellects, illuminated with congruent beliefs and corresponding convictions and certainties, despite differences in capacity and outlook. There also points to his necessary existence in unity the agreement of all sound, luminous hearts with their mutually corresponding unveilings and their congruent witnessings, despite differences in method and manner. Then, the traveler looking closely at the world of the unseen and voyaging in it with his intellect and his heart, knocked inquisitively on the door of that world, thinking to himself, what does this world have to say? The following occurred to him, it is to be clearly understood that behind the veil of the unseen is one who wants to make himself known through all these numerous finely adorned artifacts, full of art in this corporeal manifest world, and to make himself loved through these infinite sweet and decorated bounties, and to make known his hidden perfections through these innumerable miraculous and skillful works of art, and who does this by act rather than speech, and by making himself known by the tongue of disposition. Since this is so, of a certainty he will speak and make himself known and loved through speech and utterance, just as he does through deed and state. In which case, from his manifestations we must know him in respect to the world of the unseen. Whereupon he entered that world with his heart and saw the following with the eye of his intellect. The truth of revelations prevails at all instants over all parts of the world of the unseen with a most powerful manifestation. There comes with the truth of revelation an inspiration proceeding from the one all-knowing of the unseen, a testimony to his existence and unity far stronger than testimony of the universe and created beings. He does not leave himself, his existence and his unity only to the testimony of his creatures. Rather, he speaks with a pre-eternal speech consonant with his own being, the speech of the one who is all-present and all-seeing everywhere with his knowledge and power is also endless, and just as the meaning of his speech makes him known, so does his discourse make himself known together with his attributes. The traveler recognized that the truth, reality, and existence of revelation has been made plain to the point of being self-evident by the consensus of 100,000 prophets, peace be upon them, by the agreement among their proclamations concerning the manifestation of divine revelation, by the evidences and miracles contained in the sacred books and heavenly pages, which are the guides and exemplars of the overwhelming majority of humanity, confirmed and assented to by them, and are the visible fruits of revelation. He understood further that the truth of revelation proclaims five sacred truths. The first, to speak in accordance with man's intellects and understandings, known as divine condescension to the minds of men, is a form of divine descent. It's a requirement of God's dominicality that he endows all of his conscious creatures with speech, understands their speech, and then participates in it with his own speech. The second, the one who, in order to make himself known, fills the cosmos with his miraculous creations and endows them with tones speaking of his perfections, will necessarily make himself known with his own words also. The third, it is a function of his being creator to respond in words to the supplications and offerings of thanks that are made by the most select, the most needy, the most delicate, and the most ardent among his beings, true man. The fourth, the attribute of speech, an essential concomitant and luminous manifestation of both knowledge and life, will necessarily be found in a comprehensive and eternal form in the being whose knowledge is comprehensive and whose life is eternal. The fifth, it's a consequence of divinity that the being who endows man with impotence and desire, poverty and needs, anxiety for the future, love and worship should communicate his own existence by way of his speech to his most loved and lovable, his most anxious and needy creatures who are most desirous of finding their Lord and Master. The evidences for the existence in unity of the necessary existence offered in unanimity by universal and heavenly revelations, which contain the truths of divine descent, dominical self-proclamation, compassionate response, divine conversation, and eternal self-communication, constitutes a proof more powerful than the testimony for the existence of the sun brought by the rays of sunlight. Our traveler understood this, then looked in the direction of inspiration, and saw that veracious inspiration indeed resembles revelation in some respects, and is a mode of dominical speech. There are, however, two differences. The first, revelation, which is much higher than inspiration, generally comes by the medium of the angels, whereas inspiration generally comes directly. So too, a king has two modes of speech and comment. The first consists of his sending to a governor a lieutenant equipped with all the pomp of monarchy and the splendor of sovereignty. Sometimes, in order to demonstrate the splendor of his sovereignty and the importance of his command, he may meet with the intermediary, and then the decree will be issued. The second consists of his speaking privately in his own person, not with the title of monarch or in the name of kingship, concerning some private matter, some petty affair, using for this purpose a trusted servant, some ordinary subject, or his private telephone. In the same way, the pre-eternal monarch may either, in the name of the sustainer of all the worlds and with the title of creator of the universe, speak with revelation or the comprehensive inspiration that performs the function of revelation, or he may speak in a different and private fashion as the sustainer and creator of all animate beings from behind the veil in a way suited to the recipient.